Hello. So the point of this video podcast thing is to give you a better visual representation of what we mean by reconstructing arguments to it. It's quite difficult to explain over a podcast how to actually reconstruct an argument by just saying PQ, PQ, QP, QP, and etc. And it can get lost quite sometimes. It's easy if you can visualise it in your head, but if you can't, then we're left with the problem of how do we actually show you how to do it. So I'll go through a series of arguments with you, show you how we can deconstruct them and put them back into standard form. So just to familiarise yourselves and remind us exactly what a standard form is, we layer arguments out and as a series of premises leading to a conclusion. So we would have premise one, always going at the top, followed by premise two, premise three, premise four, etc, etc, etc. We would then have an inference bar. It's called an inference bar because it infers whatever came before onto whatever's next, and then leading to our conclusion. And that, really simply, is standard form. If this isn't the first conclusion, then we would simply just label that conclusion 1, then moving back onto premises, so premise 3, and eventually in the second inference bar, leading to our main conclusion. Okay, and bear in mind this can keep going and going and going and going. Notice how the premises are numbered and the conclusions are numbered. From there, we can also add in hidden premises. Hidden premises also start their own number chain, so hidden premise 1, hidden premise 2, and so on and so forth down to it. Just to sort of draw attention to here, the intermediate conclusion. Remember that an intermediate conclusion is like a stepping stone all the way down. So it's not the main conclusion of the argument, it's not the main thrust of the argument, it's just the thing in between that makes the argument flow. That's a terrible way to explain it, but it's the easiest way to actually think of in that regard too. So let's look at an actual argument to kind of see what we can see what we can do with it. So why do we insist on school uniform? If pupils wear school uniform, behaviour throughout the school will improve, obviously. We're hardly fascist, right? Stop whinging and put your tie on. Morning checks note that pupils in school are wearing uniform today, so we can expect a quiet day. So from that, we have to, first of all, remove everything we can't use and only keep the things that we can actually use when reconstructing the argument. So the thing we need to identify in the first instance is the conclusion. And we can see quite far down that the conclusion is pointing towards so we can expect a quiet day. So is one of the key words that point towards the conclusion that the argument is trying to prove. The first thing we do is go through it and remove anything that's not needed. So why do we insist on wearing school uniform? It's a question. We don't use questions, so we can get rid of that straight away. If pupils were to wear school uniform, behaviour throughout the school will improve. That's a statement, and it's a major premise because it says if then or if the, and that lets us know where we're going to go next with it. Obviously is an exclamation, and obviously it can't be used, so we get rid of that as well. We're hardly fascist, right? This is a question, so we get rid of that. Stop whinging and put your tie on. It's telling you to do something, so it's a command, so we get rid of that, as well as what came before. Morning checks note that all pupils in school today are wearing uniforms, so we can expect a quiet day. So we've got rid of everything that we have in the argument that we can't use. So we then need to reconstruct this in a way that we can actually use it. And again, what we want to do is to put this into standard form. So when we display it, we start off with our premise one. And we already have the major premise early on in the argument. If pupils wear school uniform, behaviour will improve. So we write it out in full. If pupils wear uniform, I say write it out in full, but I'm obviously not going to write it out in full. If pupils wear uniform, behaviour will improve. Next premise. Morning checks note that pupils are wearing uniform. So, morning checks morning checks note that pupils are wearing uniform. Inference bar. Conclusion. Behaviour will improve. we can leave it like that, because it's confirming things that have been on earlier on in the argument, or we can go further with it and we can try and add a wee bit more to it, because the conclusion doesn't actually say behaviour will improve. It will say we can expect a quiet day. And so we need to read between the lines a little bit here to try and kind of pull out a little bit more. So we can actually call that an intermediate conclusion. We can add in a hidden premise. This is going to be our first one. Good behaviour results in a quiet day. Now remember, hidden premises aren't explicitly stated within the text. They're hinted at within the text. So we do have a wee bit of freedom to kind of to say what we want with them in that regards to it. And then it brings us on to our final conclusion. So we another inference bar, a final conclusion, we can expect a quiet day. Now, I've went with an intentionally difficult one, so it's not just standard sort of all cats have tails, palm is a cat, palm is a tail, so that you've got a better idea. This argument actually displays everything you need to know, premises, intermediate conclusions, and obviously the inference bar in standard form as well too. You could reconstruct it a different way. You could actually put the hidden premise up into the main body of it and have the conclusion there, we can expect a quiet day. So hidden premise, good behaviour results in a quiet day, therefore we can expect a quiet day. We can really, really easily display it like that, so you've got a better idea of the multiple ways that we can actually lay it out. So, we'll do the same sort of thing, and we'll lay it out the exact same way. So if pupils wear uniform, behaviour will improve. P2, we'll simplify this. Pupils are wearing uniform. Hidden premise. Inference bar, conclusion. Oops. So you can see that the argument logically follows down to it. I personally prefer the other way because it's more declarative in it, but we can also convert this into standard form as well, just to kind of show you that it does work. So if pupils wear school uniform, P, behaviour will improve, Q, pupils are wearing school uniform, P, and eventually we do get to Q down there to it. So PQ, PQ, which is deductively valid. The next argument we're going to look at is a wee bit more complicated, but again, just as easy to reconstruct. Gay marriage, you're kidding, right? If a man marrying a man or a woman marrying a woman was okay, then the Bible would say it was. Have you even read your Bible? You should. It clearly states that it's wrong, wrong, wrong. So gay marriage is wrong. Let's stop all this nonsense and start governing. Jeez. If I go through this again, same way, I delete everything I don't need. So I'm going to get rid of the question. Gay marriage is a question. It's a rhetorical question, but we still get rid of it. Remember that rhetorical questions can be used as hidden premises, or they can be converted into statements as well. So then we get to the next bit. If a man marrying a man or a woman marrying a woman was okay, then the Bible would say it was. Have you even read your Bible? Again, it's a question, so we can't use it. You should. That's a command, even though it's part of a sentence. It clearly states that it's wrong, wrong, wrong. I'm actually going to get rid of the two wrongs because it's rhetoric and we don't really want to use it. So gay marriage is wrong. Let's stop all this nonsense and start governing. It's a command, so we get rid of that. Jeez. And it's an exclamation. So when we've got that, we have a pretty coherent argument. And then we can reconstruct that into standard form to kind of show its structure and start critiquing it. So same thing again, premise one. We have an if-then, so that's the major premise. If a man marrying a man was okay. Then the Bible, it's a big one. Say so. Okay. Next one, it clearly states it's wrong. It being the Bible. And then inference bar again. Gay marriage is wrong. Now, you can throw in hidden premises here to say that a man marrying a man was okay, when we're not actually kind of saying that's gay marriage. It's inferred by the context. Again, you can add hidden premises, but then the list of hidden premises you can add end up becoming quite inexhaustible. So we can add that if you want, but it's not necessary for this to actually work. And what we have there is quite a coherent sort of a PQ all the way argument all the way down. So we convert this into algebraic form to try and test it to see if it works. If a man marrying a man was okay, that's a P. Then the Bible would say it's okay, so that's a Q. The Bible states it's wrong, so that's a not Q. So gay marriage is wrong, that's not P. So we have a good argument. We have both a valid and sound argument. Well, you could maybe question the soundness of premise one, I guess, especially given the climate, but it's a valid argument. It's PQ, not Q, not P, and it fits into one of our standard form arguments. So it's quite an easy one, actually. Maybe I should have started with that one, but hey-ho. So I hope this has been useful to kind of show you how we piece together arguments and how we use arguments to it. Thanks for listening.